G'day guys and girls, and welcome back to another edition of Damo's Team Talk. This time, coming out of round 9. For some people, it was a lot of mayhem, disastrous, with a fair few primos going down with injury, subbed off early and the like. But I was very, very lucky, which you'll see in a moment when I go through my score and team. I managed to dodge a fair bit, just channeling my inner Neo, or aka
Mr. Anderson, welcome back.
But he is one that I didn't go for in terms of trading options. Of course, if you like our content, if you enjoy what we do from week to week, whether it be the team talks or the fully blown weekly episodes on YouTube or on podcast, depending on how you like to consume it, feel free to subscribe below and let us know that you, I guess, enjoy our work, because that's how we know that you're liking what we do. And as always, if you have any comments, questions, recommendations, even if it's with regards to guests that you'd like to see us have a chat to, feel free to comment below. But yes, if you can subscribe to our channel, of course, every week I do go through this ad nauseum, but we are looking to gain 1,000 followers. So if you can help us in our pursuit, that would be awesome. All you need to do is just click subscribe below and you are an absolute legend. So on with the show. Let's check out how we went in round 9. Well, there we have it. That's our score, and was a very good score in comparison to others out there, because our round rank, you can see there, is 1,038th. That was our ranking in terms of our score for the week, and scored, of course, 2,330 in the top 1%. And most pleasingly, in terms of ranking, I more than halved my rank for the fourth week in a row to now sit inside the top 2K. So I'm getting closer and closer to it being inside that top 1K. And that's what I want, to go from the four numbers down to three. So tracking it nicely there. Still the 15 trades, and team value is getting up there as well. So it shows that the appreciation value is correlating with the amount of points that my team is generating from week to week in recent times. So let's jump in and check out how my team went individually in terms of players. So this is how it looks. This is it in terms of VC and Cs. As you can see there, in terms of just quickly VC and C options, I did have the VC on the pink sweaty pig himself, of course, the man with the oink oink snout in trough action. Had to put the VC on him first up. How could you not? 1-9-10, I was actually literally about to sit down in my seat and watch my mob in Carlton put in a pitiful performance against the Dogs as the Melbourne game was finishing, and saw that that Clary had scored 120. And usually if you score 120, that's kind of like the minimum, 125 plus, and that's a lock-in. So it's kind of on the cusp. And the other option was, of course, before the Bulldogs and Carlton game kicked off, to put the C on Bont, who has been in crazy, crazy form. But I figured, you know, Clary was close enough to the 120 to 125 mark, I'll lock it in. Or at least, you know, assess my options if I wanted to go for Dawson come, you know, the Sunday games. And for the time being, just put the C on Madden. And lucky that I did, because, of course, Bont only scored the 112. I mean, only 7 points difference between him and Klaz. The other option, of course, though, was Dawson, who scored an 89. And, of course, the 1 week that I traded, the first week I traded him in, and he scored shit. So thanks for that, Jordan. But anyway, let's rewind things. I'm going to head back to defense, and we'll go through each line by line in terms of performances. So as I said there, Jordan Dawson, nice little segue for a shit performance first up in my team. So hopefully he bounces back. I was disappointed because against the Saints, they really conceded a fair few points to defenders and wing defenders, which he kind of fits the mold in, and playing through the middle as well. And of course, you know, the Crows put in an awesome performance against the Saints, and I thought he might have been a chance of having a massive score. But the one thing with his game was his disposal efficiency was absolutely putrid, which really did hold back his score. So I think he had around about 30 disposals or thereabouts. Let me just have a quick squeeze. Yeah, he had 33 disposals and only scored an 89, and that was his second lowest score for the season. So hopefully he can bounce back against the Dogs. But yeah, I mean, he's my latest recruit, and yeah, put it a shit one first up. So crack the whip on you, Jordan Dawson. But on with the show. And next to him, Stewart performed quite well, 115. Jay-Z, again, going from strength to strength. Genuine keeper now. I mean, question marks were still over him maybe 3 to 4 weeks ago, but he's killing it, which is really good to see, especially with the flexibility that we have with Sheasel as well in opposite lines. Nicky Dacos, seagull as usual, 125. Big tick, of course. Jackie Sinclair was probably the biggest disappointment behind Jordan Dawson for the week. He hasn't really fulfilled potential since I brought him into my side. And I said he was probably one of the more value selections over the past, you know, 2-3 weeks. And he's continued to actually just drop in price because, I mean, 65 this weekend, or round 9, just gone. He's not good enough. So, again, it should have been a semi-favorable matchup, but again, it's probably hard for St Kilda. They were smashed, but his disposal efficiency was up the shit. It was actually worse than Dawson's. So that really did hold back his score overall. So that was that there. So just pull up your socks, Sinclair. Yeah, absolute plotter. Ching Cotter, that kind of rhymes. He was another one who was disappointed, but I mean, everyone is fielding him at the moment. Like 79% of people are starting him on field, so kind of negates the the shit score, I guess, in a sense. But one thing that annoys me is that all the bench players virtually outscored him. Like a Weddle, 65, outscored him. Wilmot, who I could have opted to play in the place of Ching Cotter, again outscored him. I think it was actually his biggest score of the year, Wilmot. It was, which is good because he's kick-started his cash generation again, which is great. And a bit of a bonus as well because I'm looking to keep him across the buys to give me a bit of coverage, especially for around 14, 15, or 15 especially. Cowan, of course, didn't play, looking to potentially move him on this week as a bit of a downgrade option because there are a slew of downgrade options this week in comparison to weeks coming up, I think. Onto the midfield, so Bont, 112, below production by his standards in recent weeks. I mean, lofty standards. So he's allowed to have an off game. So we'll give you a leave pass there. Bont, Oliver, 119. Again, he was probably down on production as well. Had a late flurry in the game against the Hawks to score on 119. Not the worst, but also not the best. But I saw it as a opportunity to lock it in, mainly because there were so many guys that were going down through injury, and I didn't want to risk putting the captaincy on, you know, a Bont or a Dawson if something did happen, and I was kicking myself, which a fair few people were that opted to roll the dice on Dawson as the captain. That was that. Sammy Walsh actually performed better than I thought he would, considering the overall performance of Carlton was just absolute shit. You can really tell the passion in my voice when I talk about them. Just absolute disappointment. He's again tunned up, fifth time in a row, over 115 as well. So going from strength to strength, holding his price as well, which is good. And he's a relative pod as well, so he's at 7%. Selection, sorry, you can't see that. Apologies, folks. Let me just squeeze that back across. There we go, you can see it now. He's in 7% of teams, so he is a relative pod if he happens to have a big blinding game like he did against St Kilda. So hopefully he has one around the corner, does happen to perform well against the Pies, who he has this coming week, and then the Swans as well, who he has performed well against in 2 out of his last 3. So a bit of a tick there. Rory Laird, he was subbed out, unfortunately, late in the game, but it was only precautionary. So if you haven't heard any news, and you're hearing it from me for the first time, Matthew Nix in the presser said it was just precautionary, just management of his minutes because he has been a little bit sore in recent weeks. So nothing to worry about there. Tom Green, 97, down on production. Main thing with him was he just wasn't tackling. He didn't like a hug this week, really. He had one tackle, I think. One, which is his lowest for the year, compared to his previous 2 weeks, which was 9 and 13. So I think he was just all hugged out from the previous 2 weeks. It was Mother's Day. Come on, mate, what are you doing? He must have been hugging his mum, and he's just like, get off me. And off the back of that, he's like, I'm not hugging anyone in the game. So that's that. But Errol Gordon, again, chef's kiss. I mean, for those people who traded him, there were a few, believe it or not, a couple of weeks ago when he put in a shit one, or at least round 6, I should say. He's bounced back in style since then. And he scored 119 and back-to-back 156 scores over the past couple of weeks. So insanity. And went up 68.8K. Holy shit, didn't realize that. To be his highest price point for the year. I suppose back-to-back 156. I mean, you can't complain about that. And that's the reason why. And he's projected to go up another 46.1K if he can score a 108. So insane. Break even of 7. Amazing. But he's in 47% of teams. So if you haven't got him, what are you doing? Get him in if you can. He's going to be a keeper. Was always going to be a keeper, so don't think about trading him. Will Day, 88. Again, it's going to be up and down, I think, playing for the Hawks overall, but they play the Coasters this week. So I think he will be in for a half-decent score, hopefully, anyway. Matthew Johnson used him as a bit of a loop, which was nice, handy. Looped on Sam Simpson. He's 65. In the ruck, Sean Darcy, again, reclaiming that that hot form that he had in recent weeks with a 151, which came from nowhere. I wasn't expecting it at all against the Swans. So he's high score of the year and bound to go up in some price again, you would think. But yeah, he's actually, is he number two ruckman? Yeah, he's the second high scoring ruckman as well at the moment. So going well. Use Madden as that loophole non-playing player option. Rowan Marshall, a bit of holler. A Marshall, he scored a 131. He's got up 32.7K, and he's scoring well. He's back to scoring well enough now. Like, he had a bit very, very slow start to the year, and his past three games has really amended that. So good to see he's hitting his straps. Timmy Taranto up forward. Disappointment again. Disposal efficiency, major issue with him from week to week. He's almost in the realm of a James Warple. You can just come to expect it. He's a fantasy player first and foremost. Obviously doesn't factor in disposal efficiency, but yeah, with his wayward kicking, it does hold back his score, even though he actually played quite well and racked up the pill at will, poet, and didn't know it. Josh Dunkley, 103, standard. Rosie, 105, again, standard. Cogs, a 93, a little bit down in production, but is what it is. And Harry Sheasel had a little bit of a down game, but again, as I always say when he has a down game, he's a first-year player, so can't be too displeased with that she's nuts, because he loves to go nuts, and when he does, we love it in turn. And then Roberts, I ended up using him as a loophole to loop on Samson Ryan Score, who played first up. And Seamus Mitchell, 74 as well. So they're both making, or continue to make, good bank. So Samson Ryan's gone up 36.1K again, which is nice to see. And projected, his break even's 12. So he's projected to go up to 29, you know, touching the 30K, and potentially another 10 to 20K over the next couple of weeks leading into the buy. So he's someone that I'm going to hold on to and potentially use as a bit of an upgrade option in round 15 to say like a, you know, a Lockie Neal potentially and switch someone for like a Sam Simpson. So that's the plan with him. So he's gone well. Made his bulk cash. Bit of a sliding doors moment there. He was the option that I went for instead of Van Ruin. So I am happy with that in retrospect. And Seamus Mitchell, who everyone's pretty much got in 45% of teams, went up 22.4K, nice score at 74. So he is actually scoring not too bad as a rookie, and projected to go up another, you know, close to 50K over the next couple of weeks as well. But again, someone I'm going to hold across the buys and then potentially use him as a bit of a downgrade. But that forward defensive swing, much like Sheasel and Zeeble, is very, very handy for the time being. And that's pretty much my team as it stands at the moment. So let's delve into my plans for round 10. And before I do that, actually, I'll just make some quick changes. So first up, in terms of, I'll touch on quickly as well, first up, in terms of VC and C, so Clary plays first up, keep the VC on him. And in terms of the captaincy, I'll have to have a look into it a little bit closer. Probably Bont again. He scored a 199 three games ago against the Crows. Who does Darcy play? Ooh, the Cats. And while she, as I said, scores well against the Pies, but it's not so much I don't trust him. I don't trust my mob income. Brisbane play Gold Coast. Dunkley, maybe. But I reckon for the time being, I'll just whack it on Bont. But yeah, see how we go with that. In terms of, so the trades for next week. So I am, as you can see, they're down to 15 trades. And like I've been saying, it's probably a little bit less, maybe 1 to 2 trades at least, less than what I was hoping to have at this stage of the season. However, I have used this strategy to upgrade rather fiercely and go on the attack early in the season, use my boosts to really capitalize on upgrading my team ahead of most people, which is probably the reason why I'm jumping in ranks quite quickly, which is good to see, and it is paying off. Just in the number of keepers I've got, like in terms of the rookies, I've got 19 keepers. So I've got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 keepers. So it means I've only got 1, 2, 3 rookies on field. I could potentially loop these rookies on, as you can see, depending on who's playing first and whatnot. But I think for this week, I do need, I'm not going to be able to do anything in terms of upgrading players because I don't have cash in the bank. And again, I'm in a probably fortunate position where I've maybe got 2 to 3 players or keepers more than what most people do. So I can afford to really sit back and, sit pretty virtually and really have confidence in the keepers that I've got to score well enough from week to week and continue to score like I did on the weekend. So I think the tactic this week, if anything, just looking down here, you'll see the most traded in players, and it's no coincidence that 4 of the top 5 are all rookies. But it comes down to who do you go for? And I think in this week, compared to most weeks, really, we'll need to wait for teams to, we always need to wait for teams to be released, but more so this week than any other, because Harry Sharp could lose his spot if Rich comes back to the team, for example. Tom Berry, I mean, Gold Coast have a few players to come back to the team, like Lockie Weller and the like. So he may lose his spot. Atkins is another one who Liam and I warned about in our weekly episode last week. Bailey Humphrey, he should win the Rising Star nomination this week. Had an absolute blinder. Mid-forward, which is super handy. Only downside is, and he's got the lowest break-even, I think, of all rookies. Only downside is, obviously, the high price point means that if you're going to bring him in, you almost need to trade someone like a Wilmot down to him in order to make some bank, or tip in a little bit of cash from your salary cap to, or from your piggy bank, your savings to, upgrade someone like a Cowan, or upgrade someone like a Cowan, more of a sideways trade, but sideways him to a Bailey Humphrey, and really ride his cash wave, like we did with Setterfield, or like I did with Ryan, who I brought in when he was around about 150, 160 odd, thereabouts, and used him as an opportunity to jump on because of the favourable role and get a lowish break even at that stage. And yeah, as the first ruck. So we could use this to our advantage, more so longer term. Sorry, you can't see on the screen there. It's just hovering over Bailey Humphrey. So he's probably the second option. I think the first option is probably still Blake Drury. Didn't score well, obviously, with a 17. Still got a negative 10 break-even. But at this stage of the season, whilst we still want to be making cash or bringing in cash cows that are going to make us money for the second half of the year, more importantly, I think at this stage, is we need at least a bit of a guarantee or a suggestion that they're going to keep their spot over the course of the buys, because especially around 14, around 15, where we're hardest hit, where the more teams have buys across both of those 2 weeks. And for me, it probably comes down to, like, Bailey Humphrey, as we know, Gold Coast and Geelong have that really the only buy in round 13. North don't have, they're actually not playing the round 15, so he's going to be of no benefit to me for that week, Blake Drury. But he's going to obviously net me the most cash by downgrading to him. And he's going to help me for round 12, 13, and 14. And I don't need much help on round 12 and 13. 14, yes, a little bit. but I've only got about 16 players, 15 to 16 players in round 15, which Bailey Humphrey would help me with. So do I bite the bullet and use a trade virtually to sideways a Cowan to him? If I was to downgrade someone like a Wilmot to him in order to make bank with the trade, again, that probably just cancels each other out because Humphrey's going to play that same week, round 15, as Wilmot. So I'm not getting any benefit in terms of an extra man on field for round 15 if I was to do that trade, for example. So I've got a little bit to think about, but I think Lachie Cowan's going to be in the gun out of any of the rookies I've got there. Like, these guys are still making bank. Simpson is. Wilmot is now because he kick-started his cash generation. And small enough or low enough break even. And Weddle likewise as well scored quite well. So hopefully Matt Johnson as well comes back to the Dockers, but off the back of a win, maybe not, but fingers crossed. See how we go. But yeah, at least we've got like Johnson or, you know, Constable and Roberts as a bit of an option to use as loophole options for the rookies off the bench. So that's pretty much where I sit or stand or lay down, whatever you want to say, heading into round 10. Happy with the team, with how it's going. I think I'm just going to have to ride the bumps. Like, all these guys are keepers now, and just back them in. Like, I think this is the first week where both my ruckmen have scored over, you know, 120 plus. So that's a big plus. You're going to have guys like this, like keepers that have an off week. But if all these guys perform on the same week, like, it's going to help catapult me up the ranks quite nicely. So hopefully that combined with the fact that depending on, you know, which teams play first, if I can loop on a rookie's score off the bench like I did on the weekend, that'll really help me. I guess in terms of, like, I've only got three rookies to worry about now on field. And if I'm able to offset the risk by being able to, you know, screen their scores and loop them off the bench, it's going to really, really help me. This week, round 10, in terms of like Roberts, he plays in the second game, so I won't be able to use him as a loophole option. So I'm going to have to like play either Ryan or Mitchell straight out. Could potentially play Mitchell against the Coasters. But Ryan's been performing quite well as the first choice ruckman. So, and I think they were saying that Richmond had the most hit outs to advantage all season last week in round 8 when Samson Ryan was the number one ruck outright. So it shows statistically that also that, you know, Samson Ryan's playing quite well and the coaching staff love what he's doing. So I'm going to have full faith in him there, play him outright, take the E off Roberts, put it on Mitchell. Carlton play the second last game, so I could potentially, depending on when the game finishes, put Weddle as the emergency. If he scores well enough, loop on, you know, if I keep Cowan, maybe it won't work. I could look like loop on Cowan and then take Weddle's score and bypass Chincotta. But as I said, a lot of people are playing Chincotta anyway, so it kind of negates that risk or offsets it a little bit. And then in terms of the midfield, I've got Constable who plays straight after the Cats, actually. So again, put Simpson on the bench, loop him on, and then if he doesn't score well enough, put Wilmot on field. Hopefully Matt Johnson comes back this week and make cash, as we said. I don't know what to do in terms of the downgrade. This is kind of like make or break almost. It's like going to be a sliding doors moment. I can see it right now at this point in the season. If I was to go for Blake Drury, it would literally just mean Cowan, Wilmot goes back into defense. If SuperCoach works. Jeez, it was really slow opening as well tonight for some reason. Just by the by. And I've got enough cash to bring in Humphrey, so I'll have to weigh it up. But I'm definitely going to wait for Thursday team sheets. Like, I'm not confident in Sharp keeping his spot with the amount of Inns to come back into Brisbane. I could even go for Nevitt as well, who he's got a negative 25 break even. And he actually looked really good. He's got back-to-back 70 scores now. But again, it's the Chris Scott factor. I just don't trust him with young players on the team. Played the most minutes. So he's potentially another one to look at in 2% of teams as well. Say for example, if I was to go for Humphrey, Wagner, Drury, there he is. Drury. So to give me, the main thing with this is it would give me cash in the bank to, you know, use as my next upgrade potentially. Like, say for example, if I was to wait for Ryan to hit the 500k mark, in terms of those guys on my watch list, Lachie Neal's probably top of the list. Sicily was, but again, I don't trust him. Get rid of Dawson now because he's in my team. So I'm ticking him off as we go. So getting there slowly but surely. I'm going to get rid of Jack McRae now. He's not worth it. He's not going to be a top eight scoring midfielder. That's for sure now. Brayshaw, I don't trust. Had him last year. I spoke about him, Liam and I both did, in the weekly podcast or vodcast last week. But Lachie Neal, again, he hasn't been hitting the heights that he has in previous seasons, like the only the 109, which is helpful for us, could potentially go to another 22.8K. He's got the buy in round 12, so he'd be someone to get for round 13. So, you know, if that was the case, if he was to hit the low of 558, or low in this sense, for me, it means that, you know, if Ryan goes up to hopefully 400, we could use this 124 plus maybe another downgrade to bring in, say, another rookie or another player that's going to play around 15 to help me out. It'll literally be, you know, Ryan up to Neal and swing someone like a Sam Simpson forward. And then, yeah, hopefully continue to sort of loop in the best rookie scores between, say, Sam Simpson and Seamus Mitchell if they're both up forward. Or do a bit of a switch with Seamus Mitchell into defence, bring Zeeble up forward. That's pretty much my plan for the next 3 weeks at least, or 4 weeks. Hopefully Neal stays down. So I'm not too displeased with these shitty scores because he's actually helped me. But yeah, a little bit concerning though that he scored shit against Essendon because they're the highest, or the team that he scores or averages most against. So interesting. But if I stick with that, that's kind of how the team's going to look. I could even potentially loop on Drury score now that Wilmot's in defense. And if he scores shit, then put Simpson on field. Wilmot, I could, when's Brisbane play middle of the round? It wouldn't really work. Constable. Yeah. Oh, they play Brisbane. No, it does not work. But anyway, yeah, that's pretty much how my team looks at the moment. Again, I'm not set on that downgrade option. But, we'll see how we go. I think I am keen to at least use a downgrade this week. I'm kind of coming to a little bit of a slow in terms of the amount of trades that I'm making now. Did a bulk of my trading already ahead of the pack, whereas a lot of people would be trying to, you know, I guess they'd be flicking the trade switch and the trade machine and be chugging along and, you know, trying to get in as many guys as you can. But I think the trouble is now that these rookies that are on the horizon aren't the best or reliable at the moment. So, we'll see how we go. But that's pretty much it, guys and girls. Thanks again for tuning in. If you like what we do, as I always say, if you can hit that subscribe button, just to let us know that you enjoy our content from week to week. Again, if there's any questions you may have about, my own strategy and the way I've gone about things and what my plans are heading into the buys, and just on that as well, make sure to tune in to the full weekly episode, which will be released on Tuesday, what's that, 16th of May, where we will be delving into a little bit more detail about the buys, which I think from here on out until the buys hit in round 12. We'll be delving into a little bit more detail. But yeah, again, any comments, questions you might have about certain players that I haven't touched on already, you know, compare the peer type scenarios, or even questions with regards to your own team, feel free to leave them in the comments below. But yeah, until next time, feel free to jump into our full-length episode, as I said, coming out in a day or two's time. But until then, we'll catch you same time, same place. See you then. Thanks, guys.